Thanks for joining us. My name is Josh Topal, and I'm a program manager for Office 365. And so real quick, if you haven't joined us before, these Ignite webcasts will address different technical subjects and scenarios that are really beneficial to anyone that wants to increase their knowledge of the Office 365 suite. So today we're really excited to have two presenters, Mark Bauer and Praveen Kumar, leading our webcast. And And Mark and Praveen are both support escalation engineers at Microsoft. And today's webcast will be diving into how to use eDiscovery in Office 365. So today's session, again, provides a great opportunity to hear directly from a few Microsoft employees and learn about some of the new features of Office 365. So today's webcast will be a little under an hour, and we'll leave a few minutes at the end to field questions from anyone on the call. So you can go ahead and type your questions in the IM window. But a couple things about that. So I am recording today's session. So since we are recording, please understand that you may be captured in today's session. So if you don't wish to be recorded, please do not type into the IM window. Or if you really feel uncomfortable, feel free to leave the meeting and you can watch the recording at a different time. And I'll go ahead and paste the recording right into the chat window there. That's where it's going to be probably later today. So without further ado, Mark and Praveen, I guess you guys can just take it away. Let me see.
Praveen. Thank you. Are you able to hear me
just fine? Yeah, I can hear you just fine. Thanks.
Okay. Great. Thanks, Josh. Thanks for the introduction, Dan. Today, we will be discussing about how employees hold in Office 365. So, this slide captures the agenda that we would be discussing today. And it's primarily going to be about what exactly is in-place discovery, how do we do in-place discovery in the new Office 365, and different methods of viewing the in-place eDiscovery results, and a quick slide on some points to remember, and later we would leave it for questions. Okay. Okay. So, what is in-place eDiscovery? In-place eDiscovery can be put in as an enhanced version of multi-mailbox search that we had in 2010. So it has more features, a better way of search, and that could also incorporate SharePoint Online and other stuff. That's what is in-place eDiscovery. So this can be used for compliance management, search for items in the mailboxes, and other stuff. Okay, here we would see what's the new in eDiscovery. We know that we had eDiscovery then. So let's see what's new things that we have in eDiscovery. First of all, we have a new name. Before, as I said earlier, it was called multi-mailbox search, but now it's called in-place eDiscovery. Second, we have a new search engine. Second, we have a new search engine. This new search engine incorporates the facilities provided by the Microsoft Search Foundation. So in the Wave 15, that's a new Office 365, uses the Microsoft Search Foundation in the background to index items. So the search is more profound, more easy, and gets all the details that we need. And one benefit of this is it also, this same foundation has been used in SharePoint. And so you could do an in-place eDiscovery and a SharePoint search together so that it lists items both from SharePoint as well as from Exchange.
And because your link conversation history is in your inbox, you also get a link.
Yeah. Okay. And it also has a new UI. We know that Way 15 sports a new web-based UI, Exchange Admin Center, and this is place where we would do the e-discovery and in-place holds. There's also something called as keyword statistics. This is very much important when you're trying to create a new query. So you put, so example, you need to search mailboxes that contain e-discovery hold. So you go ahead and type a query saying that any mail that's having e-discovery or hold listed out. So depending on the number of mailboxes and depending on the number of emails, you know, that could be either a huge number of mails that's being returned by the e-discovery. And you can take corrective actions to put in more keywords or put in an and rather than an or to search. Or if it gives you very narrow results, maybe two or three just, but you need minimum 10, or you know the number, so you need to get so much results, so you could kind of maximize the search. So this keyword statistics, which tells you what keywords you use to search and number of hits against those keywords in a particular search, would help us understand whether our query, what we're using, is correct or wrong. And we have something called as eDiscovery search preview. Before, what we used to do is we do a search, and then we would have to move it to the eDiscovery mailbox to view the contents there. And later, if you want, we can move the content from eDiscovery mailbox to the any other mailbox, but this is what is the process. What if a scenario where you don't want to move the mails to the eDiscovery, just want to first understand whether the query you're using is actually giving right results or not. So in that case, we have this eDiscovery search preview, which kind of opens a virtual mailbox. You can see the items there, what items from the source mailbox that's been retrieved. It helps us to fine tune it before actually moving the mails to the eDiscovery mailbox if you need it. And the thing which we discussed earlier, integration with SharePoint, when you can actually do a search on a case, and the search returns items that match the entries from SharePoint websites, documents, file shares that are indexed by SharePoint, mailbox contents in Exchange, and archive link content from a single location. So all this is achieved using the new Way 15 by using the new Microsoft Search Foundation, because at the background, all these technologies use the same indexing for indexing the data. So now I'll take you to the process, how you would create a eDiscovery search in the new Office 365. By default, your global admin or any admin does not have discovery management rights that is given in Office 365. So we have to add ourselves to this role. So how do we do it? We log into the portal, go to Exchange Admin Center. Under permissions and admin rules, we select discovery management and add ourselves to the members list of what we want to search. And additionally, here I've also added a mailbox import export in the roles we need, because we, if you need to do a download of the PST and other stuff, we would need this role assigned to us. So along with the default discovery management role, that is mailbox search, you can go ahead and add mailbox import and export and add yourself as a member to the search. Okay. Now that we have given ourselves permissions, it's a good practice to sign off and sign in back to the portal. And once we do that, come back to the Exchange Admin Center, and under compliance management, you would have the in-place eDiscovery and hold option to do a new search. Just you had to click on the plus sign here to start a new one. It will ask you the basic entry, the name, and the search. Just choose a name which describes the search you're doing. because when you move this contents to a discovery search mailbox, a folder or folders created by this name and items that was found is being listed under that. So choose a name that makes you understand when you open the eDiscovery mailbox, you try to understand what search is there for. It could give a description. And you have, when you go click on next, and you'll have two options. One is you can search all mailboxes, and you can specify mailbox to search. Searching all mailboxes is, you do that when you're trying to understand if any emails in particular subject line or body has come into the organization or what is the originator, other stuff. When you try to do that, you do that. And specific mailboxes, you would typically do it if someone is complaining you that we had mails, but the mails got lost. And for searching if they are present in the organization, you do that. And change based on the requirement in your organization. When you click on next, you will get this option. If you see that the options are grayed out, because I just want to show this because I tried logging in without giving me permissions on the discovery management, and this is what you get. If we don't have permissions, all the things will be cleared out. You need to give yourself permissions as described earlier and then come back for you to change the options to get it. Once you give a query, the query has a lot of options. It's, as you said, it's filtered based on criteria. So you can give in a query saying that, and a query is going to be a Boolean expression. It uses, you can use AND, OR, STAR, any Boolean expression that is there. So use that. You can specify the start date, end date. You can just leave it blank. So it searches the entire mailbox contents for it. If you want to more refine the search, you can add the from list and a to and CC list. And this is the before behavior you would get if you do a search all mailboxes. When you do a search all mailbox, you wouldn't get options to do in place hold settings. Only when you do specified mailboxes, and remember, the when you specify the mailboxes, it could also be distribution lists. You can also add users to a distribution list by giving the distribution list an alias. When we create a search, the distribution list is expanded once, and all users present in that distribution list are added to this. You can also specify a time frame you want to hold the items, and a search, once you do on save, a search object gets placed in the system mailbox for eDiscovery. The search and the items are getting copied here as of now to eDiscovery mailbox. Nothing's been done. We're just creating a search. As soon as you click on save, a search object gets created and it gets placed in the system mailbox for eDiscovery. Okay, Mark?
Okay, so we also have different methods of viewing the eDiscovery results. We can estimate the search results. We can go ahead and preview the search results, and we'll give us a nice report of that. And we can also copy the search results to a different folder. Go ahead. We can also include unsearchable items. Be careful doing that. You may get unexpected results. We can also enable deduplication, and we can also enable full logging. You can also send an email to yourself to give yourself notification that the search has been completed, and you can proceed to look at the results. And by default, your discovery search mailbox will be where the results go to. You want to be careful with that if you think it's going to be a large result, because there could be a lot of information that comes out of a very large query. Go ahead. And then this is what it would look like When you open the Discovery Search Mailbox, you'll see the search results based on which mailbox you searched. Praveen went ahead and did the search against himself and did a specific date range for 7/19 and pulled everything from his inbox for that time period. Go ahead. And then one of the things I found interesting with this was how now that they have a PST export, you can go ahead and dump all this information out to a PST, which was a much asked for feature. However, when you do that, you may see this particular message. Basically, what it does is it downloads a small XML app with all the information in it, and you may see this if you haven't added the PST export or particular site to your trusted sites, and if you're not doing it through Internet Explorer. You may see this in Chrome or Firefox. So be careful when you go to do the PST export. You do it in the browser. Points to remember, the Global Admin by default does not have discovery management role. By default, we do not give people the rights to do this out of the box. You have to go in and explicitly give somebody rights to do this. A lot of times people will train their HR department specifically to do this and only give HR personnel the rights to do this, or an investigative team during a specific time frame. The default size of the Discovery mailbox is 50 gig. You may need to expand that. That's easily done. And although visible in the Exchange address list, users can't send emails to the Discovery mailbox. Also, when you create an in-place eDiscovery, a search is placed in in-place eDiscovery system mailbox. It's not a system mailbox you can see. And the search results will be copied to the Discovery search mailbox. Even if you haven't done a Discovery search before, I would suggest that you do a Discovery search so you're familiar with the process, so you know how to do it and you can go through that process. That way, when you are asked for this information, you're able to go and get this information for whoever's requesting it. Okay. Resources for in-place eDiscovery. TechNet has a great resource on it. There's also various blog articles on it. When I went out and had a case on this for the new version of Office 365, I said, hey, this is different. So I approached Josh, and we decided to do the Ignite webcast, and then I hooked up with Praveen, who had already done a blog entry on this. It is very different. You need to familiarize yourself with it and get used to working with it. It is a lot better than what it was, and I think you guys will appreciate the new in-place eDiscovery and hold process. Anybody have questions?
Hey, great. Right before we jump in, thanks, Mark. I know today's session was a little quick, but we have a lot of questions already popping up. So, Mark and Praveen, can you see the IM chat window?
Yes.
Great. And then once you guys start answering questions, I'm going to just put a couple survey questions in the background to see what kind of topics you guys are interested in. All right. So thanks a lot. Go ahead.
Mike, the documentation is out there. I can send you the link for it. That's how I found it. Let's see, what were some of the other questions? Mike can specifically ask, can we update our online documentation to call this feature out? And it is in the Hello blog. I know that's where I found the entry on it. So I'll make sure that we get that out to the make sure that's available. And yes, this does replace the old litigation hold, legal hold. And, of course, the administrative features of being able to download the slides and the presentation later. Josh will be sending out that link to everybody. You get to either have answering Fred's question, so is it a persistent hold? And you have two options there. You can specify the time frame for the hold, or you can make it an indefinite hold, and it'll be on hold until you remove the hold. The 50 gig max for all searches for each search. Your limitation there is the size of the mailbox. So if your search consumes more than 50 gig, you're going to run into a problem. You can take your search and put it down into smaller queries, or you can take one part of your search and put it in one mailbox. You can take another part of your search and put it in a different mailbox. You're not limited to one discovery mailbox. You can put it to other mailboxes for temporary purposes. Okay, let's see what some of the other questions are. You can select the message type and exclude link items. That was in response to, where was it? How does an enterprise place email on hold without placing link IM on hold? And you can select the message types. You can select, you can also select granularity of the types of items in the mailbox, whether it's email message, whether it's a calendar entry, whether it's a task or a contact. You can also segregate out a link.
To answer deduplication, it copies only the contents once. So example, if you're searching multiple mailboxes and the same email is being passed to multiple users, it doesn't pull in all the emails and just pulls in one email. So advantages of it is lower storage.
If you select that option, I can see this coming up in two different scenarios. Take, for instance, somebody sends, you're doing an investigation, you want to find out all the users that had a particular email. You would want to know and not do duplication and find out all the users that had that email. If, on the other hand, you want to find the email and you only need one copy of it, then you can choose deduplication.
And about full logging, what happens is in basic logging, once the search has been done, email is being put into the user's, the guy who created the mailbox, admin's mailbox, saying the results of it. When you do a full logging, along with that email attachment is also being dropped in the mailbox, which has a CSV file, which has the information about all the messages returned by the search. That's the difference between the basic and the full logging.
And so what's the question about filter packs for unsearchable items which are available for Office 365? Anybody have any further details about that question? Bill?
Okay. Yeah, Bill, if you have some more information about that. And I guess while we're waiting for any final questions, oh, here we go.
I should be able to search PDFs. I thought that one was included. I'll have to check on that. But the limit of the filters are what's built into the service right now. Unfortunately, you can't add specific filters. You could, of course, take everything that you get and bring it down and search on-premise with additional filters. I thought it was. I'll have to check on that. Thought the PDF filter was available in Office 365, but I will, of course, check on that. And which version are you currently on? Okay. He's currently on 2010, which I know there were filter issues there. I believe they were turned off for security reasons. But I think I'll have to check on whether that's been brought back into the newer version of Office 365 based on Exchange 2013.
And also I want to mention if Bill or if anyone else has additional questions and if something didn't get answered, feel free to reach out to me and I'll get to Mark and Praveen. And there's my information there. And so we have another question from Sammy.
eDiscovery, will an eDiscovery set discover new items added matching the query, or do you have to rerun the query manually to discover new items? It's taking what you've got in your search indexes at that particular time. It's not constantly running in the background. So you will have to rerun it and get a new estimate or export new results based on when you run it at that particular time.
And similar to that as well, as we said, you can add mailboxes to the items to be searched for, and you can also add distribution list. If you're adding the distribution list at the time of when the query is created, the distribution list is expanded once, and all the users in the mailboxes are added to the to be searched list. If in future, if the distribution list is modified, then you would have to create a new search for that because the expansion is one-time basis.
Excellent point. Thanks. And it looks like the question about litigation hold got answered. Anybody else have any additional questions? Yes, it would still be discoverable once the search is reran. The question was, if the discovery search is not reran and the message that would have matched is deleted, would it still be discoverable once the search is reran? Even if you do a hard delete on item in the mailbox, it's still going to show up in recoverable items. So it would still show up in a discovery search. And I will shy away, and hopefully somebody else can answer licensing-specific questions. The question is, we have a G2 license for Office 365. Would we need to upgrade to a G3 license to get eDiscovery?
As per my understanding, for in-place hold, you would require Exchange Online Plan 2 or higher, or the archive plan. eDiscovery, if not in plans where you don't have access to the Exchange Admin Center or the full-fledged, you may not have it. If you're having access to Exchange Admin Center, then you would have this by default. But we could take this back and get to your answer.
And so, Bridget or Jeanette responded, G3 E3 has the enterprise capabilities. What site to add to IE to eliminate the error to export to PST? When you're in that window, before you hit PST, go ahead and add that site to your trusted zones. Bill asked how many discovery mailboxes are allowed. I don't know if there's an upper limit. I'll have to follow up on that. But I know I've created at least a couple. Well, 5,000. So Jeanette responded, 5,000. Plenty of discovery email boxes. Thanks, Jeanette. Any other questions?
And again, while we're waiting, here's the information to find out about future Ignite webcasts. Next week, we're going to talk about Exchange introduction. It's going to be a real nice overview. Scott Chenal is going to prevent that. And then the week after, we're going to get to password sync on August 22nd. So look out for Thursdays. We're going to get the Ignite webcasts. But here come a couple more, guys.
Jeff Winslow, can you place 100% of can 100% of users be placed on hold? I believe the answer to that is yes. And Jeanette asked, can you not have link as part of eDiscovery when you enable Exchange eDiscovery? I think the constraint there is the fact that all your conversations go into the conversation folder. I think you can limit them from not going to the conversation folder by group policy in your local systems. I think that's an option in group policy. So you could turn that off.
To Jeff, there wouldn't be any performance impact for your tenant, but it's a huge chunk of mail items, so the search would take longer to run, and you need to have the archive plan for it to allow it. But for performance wise, it shouldn't affect anything.
Checking on what the process is for creating a new discovery mailbox. Yeah, and you can do it through PowerShell. There's a link for that. Any other questions?
All right. Well, I think that's it. Thanks again. Thank you, Mark and Praveen, for the great presentation. Thanks, everyone, for joining. Again, you can click this link. I'll have the presentation up there probably within the hour. Praveen just sent it over. The video, it's going to take a little longer. Hopefully, I'll have that by the end of the day tomorrow. If not, it'll be there sometime over the weekend. And we look forward to seeing you at our next Ignite webcast. But Mark and Praveen, thanks again. Great presentation. And have a good day, everyone.
Thanks.
Thanks. Bye.